Okay. Yeah, so actually, I mean, this picture looks like a kind of a fight between Scrum and Kanban. But if you see, I mean, as you basically go through it, I will go through it basically. So then you will find that it is not a fight, but it's just trying to understand these different concepts in a context. Fine. So and then basically the whole idea is to make sure you know in what context you can use what. So with this idea, actually, I will start this session. And just to make sure that it is, because I'm combining two different ideas in this presentation, so there may be more slides, so I will be talking a lot actually. And so what you can do is you can I mean, I Prabhat will be sharing the Slido URL on which you can put your questions, and I'll be answering those questions as well. So
Just a minute, just I shared and you guys can carry on. Yes, I can.
okay, so let's try to understand this basic idea of the scaling actually. So because as soon as we talk about Spotify or Safe, we generally talk about the scaling problems and which we are trying to solve actually with these ideas. Just and before I jump to these concepts, there I just want to make sure that Safe is a framework, but I would term Spotify as a case study. Why? Because there is no model like that. Model is something which you can which you can basically copy and you can start using. Spotify they start evolving their agile journey, and they are still evolving. So this is a continuous process. So it's like basically you started using some agile related ideas in your company, and then you are looking at it like what is working, what is not working, and you are continuously making improvements on that. So in that sense, it doesn't remain a model actually. It becomes a case study. So when we talk about a case study, there may be some ideas you can take away from that case study, but then it's not like you copy paste those ideas in your work. Fine. So with that background, I'll just basically I start the idea of the scaling problem in the product organization. So let's try to see what problem we are discussing at this point of time. So in any small organization, people generally begin with a Scrum team in and in just to make sure that I'm talking about product development. So generally, most of the people use with the Scrum team, and if they are still able to work with so they may be having more teams added to them, and they are still able to work with them because these teams may be sitting together and all that, so they should be able to collaborate with them. And again, it's not a big deal. That's fine. But then it becomes a problem actually when you are trying to manage these many teams together. Because now instead of having the communication among a couple of teams, you are talking about communication between multiple threads actually. And at the same time, what we are trying to say here is that at the end of the day, we should be able to integrate the output of each all these teams together in a product increment, which basically works for the customer. So it doesn't remain a small small problem when you think about it in this sense. So then this next question comes actually. So do we really need these many teams in product development? There are many examples because why I ask this question is because people generally say that you may want to descale your organizations. Small teams are sufficient for your product development. But then in reality, you might have seen that there are a lot of organizations who are having a big product development team. All these problems may remain there even if they are working in the most efficient way. So now the next question is like, is scaling the answer in all such cases? I think it looks like a kind of sequential idea that, okay, we have a small number of teams and now we are having the big number of teams. So let's move to scaling actually. So is it like a straightforward idea in that sense, or there's more to it? So there may be scenarios where the organizations are moving from traditional ways of working towards agile way of working. And when you work in the traditional way, there may be a lot of organizational complexity which may be inherent because of the legacy ways of working. And so you may want to say that instead of scaling this whole thing, which is a kind of backlog from the tradition, from the legacy time actually, which all those management techniques which may not be relevant in today's date, would you like to descale your organization, or do you want to see like what are the organizational complexity which you want to solve before you want to go towards a scaling scenario? And that's the one of the approach less generally takes. They focus on the descaling part before they even think about scaling out there. But then in the second scenario where there is nothing legacy about it and people are already working in an agile fashion for a longer period of time. And at the same time, when I say agile fashion, then I truly mean, I'm not really talking about hybrid agile or whatever. So I'm really specifying that they are working in that fashion and then they want to scale further. So in that case, definitely it may be a scenario where we want to scale, right? So the next question comes is like, in our world, it looks like implementing safe, less, or Spotify becomes the idea in an organization. But is that a goal actually? So the goal generally is not to apply agile in a large organization. Instead, the goal for a large organization is to become agile. And there may be a lot of different ideas when we say what we really mean becoming agile. Fine. So any ideas, what do you think like in terms of what does it mean to become agile?
Hey ShriKant, Rohan here.
Hi Rohan.
So becoming agile, would be getting into the culture, and start taking decisions or, behaving in an agile way, that is, adhering or aligning to the values and principles rather than just thinking about putting Scrum or Kanban or any other framework and more looking into that, but thinking about values first.
Cool.
And, doing whatever aligning to those values.
Sure.
What I feel.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Hey, ShriKant, Sai Krishna here.
Sai Krishna, yes.
Yeah, so being responsive to the market, trying to make sure you get the most value to the customer as soon as you can and taking their input and feedback and being responsive to that quickly, right? So you have to think about that customer and all of those things.
Yes, absolutely. I think this is a really perfect answer. So let's move to the next one, which I just wanted to discuss over here. So generally, when we talk about agile, people have different concepts in their head. And for some people, let's say we are moving towards Scrum, it is an agile. You're becoming an agile. Or you're doing, you're basically doing some ceremonies. Again, it is agile, something like that. But then it is not. If we look at the dictionary meaning, it is all about ability to create and respond to the change, quickly and with ease. That is very important in order to succeed and in an uncertain and turbulent environment. Now, all these situations people see on day-to-day basis. So for example, the COVID-19 is a completely uncertain and turbulent situation and environment right now. So irrespective of whether you're using any kind of framework or not, and you are still able to respond to those changes quickly and with ease, you are agile by definition, isn't it? So it's not just following certain frameworks, it is the intent, and intent is very important. In today's days, there are a lot of companies which are struggling want to make sure or want to make a difference towards the customer, and they have a lot of competitors in our world. So they need to make sure that they are able to respond to the changes which other competitors may be creating. Sometimes the competitors may be creating those changes. Sometimes the ecosystem may be creating those changes. Sometimes the environment itself may be creating changes. So agile is that ability to create and respond to the changes. So with this background, let's try to see what is agility in the product development space. So there may be multiple things, but I just zeroed down to three things over here. One is, are you working on the right thing? So irrespective of whether you are very efficient in delivering something or not, if you're working on the wrong thing, then everything you're doing is going to be waste. So it doesn't really make sense to just focus on the efficiency, but also need to be focused towards, are you working on the right thing? And that's where the ideas from the lean startup world or design thinking world come into picture. And the second thing is about quick feedback, which you are able to deal with ease. When we talk about quick feedback, we are talking about a situation where in case there is a problem in your product, then you are able to resolve it quickly. That is one. So that may happen when some release problem may happen. And in that case, in case you are following the continuous delivery, then it is very, simple or efficient to move towards the previous version quickly. That is one. Second is like you may be getting the continuous feedback from the customer. So they may not be providing the direct feedback, but then you may be having the telemetry or analytics tools with which you will be getting what the customer may be interested in or what kind of problems he may be getting into. So with those feedbacks, you make changes quickly. So when I say quickly, it is a kind of definition, like in case you want to push a one line of code into the production, so how much time it should take. So In many the organization, it may take, for example, a month to just to go there. But when I say quickly, that means you are able to go to the production in minutes, and then at the same time going into the production in with that speed is safe as well. So it's not like you are just going there for the heck of it, and you basically, you know, put your whole system down because of that. It's not that. It's more about going there with safety, and basically you can repeatedly go there with that speed. Then third part is innovation. So you may be creating the same ideas or working on the same ideas. Is it sufficient? Because I'll give you an example of badminton player Saina Nehwal. So she may be number one for some period of time, but then she doesn't remain number one forever, actually. So it doesn't mean that whatever you are working, you continue doing that in a similar fashion. So you need to innovate as well. And the focus of the innovation is to make sure that are we solving the customer's problem in an innovative way. So it's all about customers. Right. So if you combine all these three ideas, then you get some idea about like what agility may mean in the product development space. So we may have different tools. So we may talk about Scrum, we may talk about Kanban, we may talk about Safe or Less or whatever. Actually, all these are tools, which may help us reaching there. So it doesn't mean that tools become your goal. So implementing Safe, implementing Kanban or Scrum is not the goal. The goal is that are you reaching towards your business goal repeatedly or not? In case some tool is not working, then you are basically free to take some other tool which works for you in your context. So that is a very important idea to remember. With this context, actually, try to explain what agility is all about, what we are looking at, and where do these tools come into picture. So let me flash back to you to USA, actually. So I was there for some point of time. And then when I came back, so this was a kind of scenario which you could see in any kind of US state or city. Long roads, smooth roads, and everything is clean and really good. But then when you come back to your home, this is what it looks like. And then you try to, you basically keep thinking that why can't our India become or emulate US ways? Why can't we have so nice roads and infrastructure and everything and all that? And these questions were troubling me for some point of time, but then I try to see what can be the possible reason. So this was a question which was coming to me again and again. So then I had a conversation with one of my friends, and this idea again came that what about India and Western countries where we are having a difference and all that. And then basically he mentioned in case you are having an old building, actually, then when we are talking about India, which is a civilization of thousands of years, actually. In that kind of country, there are a lot of legacy things which we are really proud of. And it looks like a kind of old building in which, in case you want to make changes, actually, it becomes very difficult. It's not easy. So it's not like you have a flat land and you want to shape any kind of building the way you want. It doesn't happen in that way. So in case you have the old building and you want to make some changes around it, you need to be careful where and how you're going to make the changes. Fine. So this is one context. I'm just giving you the idea. So so then when you look at some of the organizations who may be working in a may have worked in traditional way for a long period of time, you may expect them to evolve from the legacy actually, but then it doesn't really make sense that they will basically revolutionize the way they work. So yesterday they were working in a completely traditional way, and all of a sudden everything changes and it becomes really awesome thing. It doesn't really happen in that way. So it is very important to understand that part. So that is what I was trying to say here, that lots of organizations come from traditional background. Then such organizations are newcomers to the agile world. So if you look at this picture, which is somebody is learning driving and another person is giving him directions. So, and I hope you also remember your own memories when you start looking for driving or learning driving actually. So at that point of time, you just follow the instruction your instructor says actually. Because you may not be having the synchronization with the machine, which is car in this case. So everything may not be part of the way your body really works. So you may be just following the instructions, so which you can think about as a kind of rule book. And you may be discussing with your friends actually that I'm facing this kind of problem, so how to solve that kind of thing. So basically you find two kind of scenarios here. So one is you basically look at the rule books, and then you also look for the cookbooks. So if you like look at this whole idea, is and this is similar to what Shu Hari basically talks about. So Shu is all about follow the rules, as you I just mentioned about you are learning the driving, and after a period of time the same rules, step one, step two, step three kind of stuff may not be that relevant, as you your body is syncing with the machine. So in that case, you may break those rules as well. Then after a period of time, when you are very efficient in driving, then you may be learning on your own as well. So some of those rules which didn't exist and maybe coming based on your own experience. So at that point of time, you may be making those rules, right? So this kind of workflow generally happens, which is focused on the foundation, understanding, and then mastery. So if you look at SAFE, that's where it generally lies. And I will tell you why. But I think I'm just trying to make sure that you understand the analogy of it, like the organizations coming from a traditional background, the old buildings, legacy part, and basically they want a cookbook, they want rules to follow, because they are very new to this whole idea actually. So so at that point of time, something like SAFE, which mentions everything from A to Z actually, really helps. It may tell you all the cookbook stories, like how to deal with this and that. So this is where the SAFE come into picture. So just to make sure that there is nothing wrong in this idea, I would also say that SAFE. In case you are in such kind of situation, in case you are following such kind of framework, it is completely fine. Now, let's try to understand a little bit about SAFe, basic ideas of SAFe. So when you look at SAFe, then it comes with a big picture. And as soon as you look at this picture, the big picture, you may become scared because there are too many things on it, actually. So let's try to see what it is all about. So in general, if you try combining the different ideas in agile world, actually, whether different frameworks, lean, Kanban, plus you may try to add design thinking on top of that, and then business agility ideas. So if you combine all these things together, then you get SAFe in your hand. Fine. So let's try to see like how it generally works. So generally, SAFe assumes that people do Scrum or Kanban at team level. And at team level, it assumes that team backlog instead of product backlog. So there has been a reason like why it is called a kind of team backlog or a team actually. It is because that the teams can follow any kind of flavor of agile, so they can use Scrum or Kanban if they want. So it doesn't make sense like in case somebody is using Kanban, then we are still talking about a product backlog, which is a Scrum term in this case. Fine. So if you try to move towards the earlier I just mentioned like the team may be working in the normal Scrum fashion or normal Kanban fashion. As you move towards program level, so what it does is that it adds the concept of the agile release train, which is nothing but is a kind of team of teams actually. So they have a term of agile release train, but it's essentially is a team of teams. So they, with this idea of team of teams, they introduce the notion of the program backlog, which is higher level than the team backlog. So so they may be having the bigger things than the stories. So these bigger things are called features in SAFe. And so there may be bigger enough things which may not be completed in one sprint. So so that's where the idea of the program increment also come into picture, which we generally call as a PI. So you may be having, so instead of, so when multiple teams are working together, so instead of looking at only one sprint, you look at the multiple sprints. So that means five sprints together. And so that may be the definition of the program increment, which may be spanning multiple iterations. And then, so that is basically the kind of definition that you have the team of teams working together. And then at the end of these five sprints, they deliver features, which may be discussed as part of the PI planning, which happens at the beginning of this PI. So this is a little bit idea on the program level. So the important part in the program level is the concept of the system team. Generally, that gets forgotten, but this is a very important concept. So what generally happens is that all such teams may be working on their own, but then producing some outputs. But then how to make how to convert those individual outputs to something with which you can create a product increment. So you may be combining all these things together and then making some sense out of them. So that's where the system team come into picture, which basically helps in the integration and making sure that in every sprint you have a product increment as well. Or program increment as well as part of it. So as we go towards a large solution, then after program level, it goes beyond and interfaces to the corporate side of things. So how we do the budgeting, how we do the portfolio planning. So it may introduce the Kanban board, so solution. So basically solution backlog. Here we may be having the abstraction of the EPIC. So it is a little bit bigger abstraction than, so that this basically happens actually here. So as you see in the portfolio level. And in this case, so this bigger level of abstraction is a kind of hypothesis. So that you may be working on that EPIC for a multiple durations of PIs actually. So this is how it generally works. Any questions before I move further? Yes.
Yeah, ShriKant, I have one question.
Yeah,
basically you said like, as we know, SAFE, it consists of multiple teams, right? Mm-hmm. So all the teams will be following like one framework, or it's fine, whatever framework they follow, is it fine with that, or how it works?
So generally, SAFE talks about using Scrum or Kanban, and teams can follow any of it actually.
Oh, anything is fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Again, there is two more questions if you want to handle right now in Slido, or it would be better to in the last.
Sure. So let's move further. So key ideas in SAFE are two things. One is two-tier planning. So apart from the planning on the sprint level, actually you do the program level planning as well. And then on the portfolio levels, the business ideas will be created and will be splitted into multiple features actually. So you have the planning on the sprint level and on the program level. Then if the important thing which I want to highlight over here is that the SAFE talks about planning on cadence and delivering on demand. Somehow there is a misconception in the software world that they feel that somehow SAFE is a waterfall kind of thing actually, where something is defined for 5 sprints and then people keep on working on that. The important idea is that these PIs have been defined as part of the cadence, like after 5 sprints, the next PI will happen. But that doesn't mean that your release is stuck because of that. So you should be able to release at any point of time. And that those ideas basically comes from a continuous delivery philosophy, where you may be able to deploy into the production at any point of time. Every commit may basically trigger and basically go to the production, even though that may not be releasable. So what it means is that those stories or those features may sometimes be half-baked, but then because they are not releasable in so they may be using a kind of a configuration based on which those particular half-baked features are not available for the public. So what I mean to say with that is, at any point of time, be using continuous delivery, whatever commit you are making, it may go to in the production, but it may not be released. And release can happen when business says it, like, okay, well, we want to go with this feature. So the team should be able to release it at any point of time. So it doesn't mean that you are stuck with your release for 5 sprints or a PI. You should be able to deliver at any point of time. So having said that, some of the key ideas I just want to mention that if you are coming from the shoe world where you have never used any kind of agile framework and your organization is new to this world, actually, it really makes sense to have something which is well defined. There is a lot of instructions, books over there, and you can start using those ideas in your world. But next important idea is that don't remain stuck on shoe level, actually. So many times it happens that whatever SAFe defines in their documentation, that becomes a kind of Bible for the people, but it doesn't have to be that way. You should be able to experiment what works for you, what doesn't work. So it is, as I said, like it may be a kind of toolbox or toolkit, actually. So some of those tools may be working for your context, some may not be, actually. So whatever may not be working, you may remove that. You may add something more from different parts of the world. So nobody stops you to take some ideas from the Spotify or some ideas from the Nexus or Less World or any other world, actually. So you should be able to experiment those ideas based on your context, and sometimes you may create your own. You may come with your own innovative ideas how to work in this environment. So with this idea, let's move towards Spotify. So earlier I talked about a scenario when you were trying to make changes in an old building, and it could be difficult. You may be coming from a legacy background, but then now you are trying to create a new shiny building from scratch. So let's try to see like how Spotify looked at it. And just to reemphasize again that this whole thing which they evolved is a kind of case study. It's not a model which can be replicated. They are still evolving right as of now. So they started as a Scrum company. So every team was working with Scrum, fine. And it was great to have some semblance of the order in chaos, actually. But then, as I mentioned before, shoe may get you started, but then you don't need to stuck over there. So shoe level practices were getting in the way. So they started relaxing on the practices and started focusing more on the principles. So instead of calling a team as a Scrum team, they start calling them as a squad, just to make sure that they should be able to experiment with any flavor of Agile. So it doesn't have to be only Scrum, and they can use XP, they can use DSGM or any other flavor as well. Second thing what they did was they renamed Scrum Master to Agile Coach, and the basic idea was that there is no master and there are no slaves. So they just renamed this role, and at the same time, it also makes sense for multiple flavors of Agile as well. So it doesn't, you don't need to be remaining a Scrum Master even though you may be using different flavor of Agile, fine. So they renamed this role to this Agile Coach. And then next point is about the important point about the squads is that it takes the end-to-end responsibility of the feature which they may be working on. So even if they may be having, Spotify may be having a different ways of getting the dependencies from different teams, or like for example, then as I mentioned before, there are some different squads as well, which are inward for focusing. So these inward focusing squads may be helping the feature level squads to create their increments. So instead of having a test automation team which may be doing the test automation for them, test automation team may be enabling the feature team to do that actually. So there is no handoff between one team to another. They may be working on a feature end to end and maybe taking help from one team or another, but they still work on one feature as one team. Second point is self-organizing, which may be coming in the next slide. And third part is cross-functional definitely as it was a Scrum team, it has to be cross-functional. So some of them, so I just mentioned about that internal facing part. So the important point from the Spotify perspective, which we can call is a kind of big driving force, is autonomy. So that guides to evolve the company pretty much. So not only it means that how to work, but also decides what do we work next as a team. And then the question may be coming like, why autonomy? So number one is like, it enables to move fast. So there may be a speed associated with it. So you don't need to stuck waiting for decisions and can always move somewhere. Second is scaling. It helps you to scale. So if squads are self-directing, we don't need central function managers and coordinations maybe there, but not that much actually. And the third point is it may be a full of motivation. So in case you are having a autonomy, which is a driving force or the key factor in the book of Daniel Pig around what basically helps teams to motivate. So it becomes a lot of fun as well. So let's try to see like when we talk about autonomy, it may also create chaos as well, because everybody may think that in case everybody is doing whatever they want, actually it may create a lot of problems. So that's where the idea of the alignment comes in picture. So alignment is all about the management is helping defining the vision and where they want to go, and they want to paint a big picture which teams really get. So they define this whole idea, and then teams help them to reach there. So when we talk about the autonomy and alignment, there are multiple factors which comes over here. One is low autonomy, low alignment. Nobody wants to go there actually. So you are not really motivated to go to your office, and there is no alignment, doesn't really work. Second is low autonomy, high alignment. So your management tells you all about the vision, what they want and all that stuff. But at the same time, they also tell you like how to get there. So both part is so that you don't have the autonomy to choose how you want to get there. So both of these things are defined. Again, that doesn't really work much. Third one is the high autonomy and low alignment. So teams are having very high autonomy, but then they don't know. They may not be going where they're going actually. Everybody is choosing their own path. So it may create chaos actually. So again, it doesn't work. So the last one is the high autonomy and high alignment. In this case, the management defines where they want to go, and how they can go there is defined by So that is where the Spotify is, or basically they try to be. So with this idea of the autonomy, which I mentioned briefly, the idea of the tribe comes into picture. So the tribe is a bucket of squads. So can you go on mute, please, guys?
Oh, please go on mute.
So it has some shared some kind of shared purpose. So let's say that in the Spotify world, we want to provide great music playing experience. We provide infrastructure to make squad faster. So all these ideas can be the example of the tribes. So these tribes are basically based on the matrix structure. And in this matrix, actually, the primary dimension, which is a vertical, actually, is squared. Fine. If you basically zoom in further, so you apart from that, you also find a horizontal dimension which is called chapters. So before I go to chapter, so squared may be having a product owner developers quality assistance, not a quality assurance designer, then test automation and agile coach. As far as the chapter is concerned, this is a, as I said, horizontal dimension. It may be so it may be have focused towards a competency. So for example, there may be some developers or backend developers and in multiple squads, and they want to communicate to each other around their personal growth and developing competency within that area. So that's where the chapter comes into picture. So as you move further, actually, so there may be multiple tribes in the organization, and that is what the Spotify has. So within those multiple tribes, there may be shared purpose, which is permeating across these different tribes. And so for example, let's say that some of the people in different tribes want to have a conversation around a shared topic, which is called leadership. Or some people want to have a focused conversation or a community around something else, actually. So that's where this idea of the guild come into picture. So just to make sure, which is a important idea in Spotify here, Spotify, the structure formation is fluid. So if you want to speak to somebody about something to solve a problem, you just do it irrespective of where you belong in a tribe. Second point is also very important. Like, for example, let's say that some people are talking to each other a lot amount of time. So in case they see that it is happening, so they may form a squad where in case those people are talking to each other a lot of time, actually. Similarly, that the idea is to form the structure. So the important idea to come out of with that is the idea is to form the structure the way communication needs to happen, not the other way around. So generally, it happens in many organizations. It happens in completely in a different ways. They define the structure, and then because of those structure, the communication need to happen in different ways. So instead of that, they define like how the communication needs to happen, and accordingly, the structures are defined. Another important point is small and frequent releases. So it is similar to SAFe as well. So they basically go towards the continuous delivery or continuous deployment path, where each commit may be the candidate or may go to the production. So just to give you an idea, in any kind of build, like for example, WhatsApp build, you may be having a lot of features which may be present in that build, but they may not be released. So they may be hidden behind some configuration, but they may still be part of the build. So similarly in Spotify as well, this similar things happen, actually. So based on the feature toggle idea, they may, or the business decision, they may switch on those features for the general public. So there was a challenge which they were facing at a certain period of time when they wanted to make the release very simple. So as you have seen that in case in traditional world, actually in case you are going for release after 6 months, it becomes a chaotic world, actually. And releasing itself is becomes a lot of time and resources from everybody. But in case what happens is like in case release becomes a regular feature or scenario, and it happens every day actually, there are all small releases. And in one day you may be doing multiple deployments, then releasing becomes doesn't really remain that kind of problems. So that's the direction basically Spotify also tried following actually, and they're following right now. So that culture basically is all about making a structure and processes around it. Just because release is hard, let's make release not hard. So that's where they found that the architecture was causing those releases very, very hard, and they just focused on fixing that. This is a very important idea, which may be a little different than what SAFe suggests. So this is called a self-service model. In this model, what happens is, as I said before, that squares don't need to have any kind of handoffs between multiple teams. So in case they need any kind of support from somebody, they should be able to have that support with them. So let's say that so this is an example or example which we see in this picture. So you have some feature squads, then you have on top of that you have client app squads. So for example, you have iOS, Android, desktop, or web squads. So they basically make sure that whatever is supposed to be delivered. So basically, all these feature squads may be working together, but then their outcome has to go in some certain client app actually. So the iOS app squad may be part of that. But then just to make sure that iOS squad doesn't basically create the build which may be going to the iOS. Instead, what they do is they create whatever is necessary for these feature squads to enable to go to the iOS to iOS iOS build. So whatever flexibility or facility they require, the iOS or Android squad may be providing that, but they don't really do it themselves. Fine. So that is a very important idea, that they may not be becoming the bottleneck in doing whatever you want to do that. They may be enabling you to do it yourself. So if you look at this idea, is similar to a buffet system. So in case you are going to a restaurant, then you may be having an idea where waiters may be serving to you. And that may be working well for quite some time. But then in case you have thousands of people, then it doesn't work that well anyways. So what people do is they go for buffet system, in which whatever's basically you want to eat, you can take the serve and you can eat that. And that way you are able to manage many number of people. So it is a similar kind of system in Spotify as well, that instead of somebody doing for you, they enable you to do it yourself. So in case you need to do some kind of automation, then they may be creating a service with which you may be able to do automation very easily. So that is where this idea is little different, where the focus is still on the same squad is able to do the thing end to end on its own, instead of they hand it over to some other squad. So the important point is that the focus in the Spotify is on the culture more. They have some defined values and principles, like for example autonomy, transparency, on which they try to shape their decisions. So they may not be following a particular process, but these driving principles may be helping them to come up to the processes which may be helping them. So there is no defined rule book which they may be following from a certain framework. Whatever basically may be working for them, they may be using it, which is according to their values and principles. Now, some of the ideas from the cultural standpoint, so they focus on experiments, fail early and fail often culture. So they may be having, they have a failure wall as well, in which people proudly mention how much they have failed, in what occasions they have failed. So failure is a kind of acceptable part of the culture. Second thing is that they keep on doing a lot of experimentation with the lean startup ideas. So in case something blows up as well, like for example, as we are doing the continuous delivery, a continuous deployment, it may happen that something blows up in a feature. So what they do is that instead of, blowing up of that feature remains local actually, that doesn't go to a different, whole product actually. So it whole product doesn't go down because of that, because of the way they have created the architecture. So in case something blows up, then it just creates a failure over there only. And then because of this, ability to fail early, actually they are able to experiment a lot of things together with this testing. So that is also a part of their culture. So when they try to take the decisions, so they don't basically look at it as whether it's right or wrong. They look at it from the trade-offs point of view. So far I just mentioned about two different frameworks. As you have seen that they may be having the completely different context, and at the same time, it doesn't mean that you cannot take some ideas from Spotify, some ideas from the Safe. You can use them together. Secondly is that they already have some context in which they may be used in a particular ways. So there may be a lot of anti-hypes around Safe actually. People have been talking a lot of bad things about Safe, and this is an important idea I just wanted to highlight. So this is called Dunning-Kruger effect, in which what happens is that when people don't know anything, so they know nothing actually, they have the high amount of confidence that whatever they're talking is right or wrong. So you may be finding a lot of people who may be talking about bad things about Safe just because they have no clue actually. They have not gone through any kind of training. They have not gone through any kind of implementation. So whatever they know maybe just be based on one article or another article, which is another ways of a kind of biased view actually. So when you go with a lot of some investigation, a valley of despair comes to picture, where you may be having a low confidence, but your competency may be going high actually. So at that point of time, you feel that you are still investigating how it really works and all that. And then after that period of time, you may be having enlightenment, where you find, oh, these are different ideas which may be there. So a lot of people generally may be talking about Safe having problems, where they may be on the peak of Mount Stupid. There, I have seen some many cases like that. So it is not, so there is a lot of anti-hype around Safe, but as you have seen that it may be suitable for organizations which may be coming from the traditional world and they may be using it. And in different scenarios also, they may be using it. So if you talk about like whether we should use Spotify or Safe, so I think this is basically comes out as an answer that it is all about based on the context. There is nothing wrong and right. These are tools which you may want to use depending on your context. And you don't have to copy whatever somebody is saying in the textbook. You need to see what makes sense for your scenario. So with that, I'm coming to questions.
So ShriKant, we have some bunch of questions on Slido.
Okay. Yeah, so just give me a sec. So how does Spotify address the challenges like release planning and dependency management? So as I said, like they may still be having the release planning kind of ceremony, which is not really specified somewhere, but at the same time, as far as dependency management is concerned, what they do is they try to shape a team which should be able to work end to end. So, and some of those ideas may be coming from Less World as well, which talks about having the feature teams. In which feature team is all about having a cross-component team in which some people from different, so like let's say that you have a business case which requires some people from the core banking, from internet banking or some other component. So when they start working together, dependency in itself gets resolved. So that is one way that all these cross component people are working together. Secondly, as I mentioned, like whoever is, they may be having that dependency with, they are able to talk to them. They should be able to resolve those dependencies. So that is second point. And third point is that in case, so there are different squads which enable them to basically resolve those dependent problems, and then so that they can do it on their own. So that is also part of it. Does it answer your question actually?
Yes, ShriKant. But just extending my question. Is it really possible, there are multiple teams, say there are around 30 to 40 teams involved for a product development. Is this dependency management really possible in Spotify?
So first of all, you don't need to interact with all 20 or 30 teams. As I mentioned, like we have a concept of the tribe in which may be working on it. Particular defined feature, and those teams may be working on that feature only. So having 20, 30 teams doesn't come into picture. And secondly, as I mentioned, like shaping those teams may be fluid as well. So in case something is not working, so they are able to change that team composition as well. So that is also part of it. And third part is like, there is more about the buffet kind of culture instead of handover kind of culture that in case it is not working for me, then I hand over to you. So the focus is more reducing handoffs. So in case something is basically dependent on something else, so they help you enable it, help you enabling you to do it yourself. So that is part of it.
Okay. Yeah. This answers. Thank you. Thank you very much, ShriKant.
So second point is why some of the agile practitioners are stating SAFe is not agile and it is just renaming of organization titles or positions. So I think one of the important point is that all these are tools and tools can be used or misused as well. So I have seen a lot, some of the organizations which just took the ideas from Spotify. They just renamed everything like squads and chapters and all that. But then the inherent culture remained hierarchical only. So there was no autonomy. So as I said, like the basic idea of the Spotify was not their different structures, squads or tribe or guilds, but the focus was more on the cultural part, which is focusing on the autonomy, ability to shape, having the fluid structures. So people take just the structural part, but they don't really focus on the cultural part. And that's what the cause problem. So coming back to SAFe, so the intent may be really good from a SAFe standpoint, but then if you are implementing it in a completely different way, then it may be causing a bad implementation as well. Doesn't that answer your question? Hello, yes.
I think so, yes, sir, but not sure who wrote the question that was in anonymous mode, so can we move further?
Yeah, so the next one is that what parameters an org should consider while choosing scaling framework? So actually, first of all, I would say that Spotify, I still consider as a kind of case study, not a framework. So it is not a even model. You cannot copy it. They are still evolving. So that is one. As far as other scaling frameworks are concerned, actually, there are different pros and cons of different frameworks. So a lot of context comes into your context. So as I said, like in case we don't want a kind of revolution or focus on descaling, then may want to use SAFe. In case you want to still, you're fine with the tough choices, and that's where you may go towards less. In case you are focusing, or you're having smaller teams, a small number of teams, then a framework like Nexus will also work. Does it answer your question? This question is about from Sunil. So assuming say that SAFe is at SHU, how does the organization know that what HA and RE look like and also when they are ready to move? So my understanding about that is you can start with SHU kind of framework. So you get the different ideas and you can start implementing them. But then after a period of time, what basically triggers you, your whether all the ideas which I mentioned around the what it really means to be really agile and agility. So there may be different bottlenecks in the continuous improvement procedure which you may be coming across with. That this particular thing is still not working, or this is not working. So this may be a continuous evolution, a part of the continuous evolution. So it's not like you just follow one practice or another. It's more about what are the problems you are facing in your business front or in your ways of working. And then accordingly, there may be, as I said, there may be different tools which may be solving the same problem. And sometimes you may be you may be shaping your own tool to fix that problem. So so a lot of practices have been coming out from the Spotify, which were not part of any different framework. So they basically evolved themselves. So evolution can happen. At the same time, you can choose, pick and choose different tools to solve those problems as well. Does this answer your question, Sunil?
Thanks, ShriKant. You know, just taking this opportunity, I think the analogy of an old building versus a new shiny building was brilliant. And excellent presentation overall, very, very good insight. My own knowledge on SAFe was very limited, and I definitely learned a few new things. Where I'm coming from is this. In my experience, and this is what makes, you know, people like us at ThoughtWorks, and I'm sorry, I'm saying this with utmost humility, but we have been an agile organization, and we have worked only that way. We don't know any other way to do it. We don't follow any framework. It's a mixture of Scrum, XP, whatever we think is right, we use that tool at that point in time. Every team in ThoughtWorks also delivers in a very different way based on the context, right? So, but the point is that, you know, where I've seen coaching become successful, or enablers or influencers become successful when you implement a framework, is people know what the North Star looks like, okay? You at least know that, okay, the next step is this. You may or may not be able to push that organization or the team in that direction. Mm-hmm. But at least you know the direction in terms of the North. What I am not seeing with SAFe is that, or maybe it's not SAFe's fault, right? But people are just interpreting that this is it. And so my point is that people, you know, there is a risk that people will just become content with whatever I have done and still be okay with whatever problems are, saying this is the best we can do. We cannot do anything more than this. We have implemented SAFe. If there are still the problems, that's it. Those are unsolvable systemic issues which we cannot push through. So I think this is where the role of an influencer or a coach comes in, saying, no, you have to push boundaries here. It's possible to do that, right? And this is where I'm saying that SAFe or somebody or the influencer, somebody has to be, you know, showing that roadmap in terms of what that ha and re looks like, saying, no, it's not okay to be at shu. This is what ha looks like, and this is how you get there. That is what the point I was trying to make, Shrika. But I get your point. I mean, I understand. And from that perspective, I actually, if you were to ask me to pick, you know, which one of the two, of course, they are context dependent. But what I really like about Spotify is the fact that they focus on the culture. For them, rules, processes are less important than doing the right thing. So I think somewhere, you know, that evolution, room for evolution is there in Spotify. But that room for evolution, I'm not seeing in SAFe.
Yeah, so I think, I mean, I'm not sure if I will be able to say whether SAFe can do or not do that particular point. But my point was to basically not get stuck over there. So
it may help
you reaching on the SHU level. So you choose, you pick and choose some of the practices which may be still working for you, and you basically evolve back from there. So.
Correct. No, I think your answer is a valid answer. I mean, I'm more saying in terms of, I think it's more the role of the influencer who plays a very critical role in saying, okay, you know, this is just not about SAFe. It you need to go beyond that, right? And I think that message has to somehow go. And what I'm seeing in organizations where we have gone and we have seen people implement saying, look, we have implemented SAFe by the book. You know, we have done whatever we could do, and that's it. So I think that is that mindset which I'm saying that, we as coaches, as influencers, you don't need to carry to the organization in terms of pushing buttons. But thanks, ShriKant.
Yeah, actually, I just want to say over there is that sometimes people may not have seen anything beyond what they see as of now. So they may be looking at saying, okay, this is the end of the world, and that's it, basically.
Yeah.
But in case, and as you rightly mentioned, that's where the influencer come into picture that. I mean, beyond that also, people are experimenting with these ideas, and this is not about a tool, this tool or that tool. It is about shaping the culture and values and principles. And in case you take it along, actually, you can keep on doing the experimentation around these ideas and evolve for them.
Perfect. Thank you so much, ShriKant. Thank you.
Yeah, ShriKant, Sai Krishna here. Another thing I want to add, even SAFe is evolving. In the sense that they're just set in stone or anything. They are also learning, bringing in concepts that they see are successful in the market, working. Even that itself is evolving, but we don't have to stay at that cadence of evolving and stick with that only. As you were rightly saying, figure out what works, figure out what doesn't work through experimentation. Once you get comfortable with what the shoe stage is, and then if something is working out for you, try it, do it. That's okay. It's okay to evolve, because each team, each environment is different. That's just a starting point to get to the goal. It's not, as you rightly said, the procedure, the processes are not the goal. The goal is to achieve agility. Right? So whatever helps you get to that, whatever practices, it's the team that evolves, right? As a team, they figure out, okay, through retrospection, through feedback, hey, this is not working for us. Can we do something different? So once we get them to think and give them the autonomy, I think that will come from within the team. But they have to get comfortable with that. We have to enable them to be comfortable. Yeah.
So actually, what I've seen is that the biggest takeaway from the Spotify case study is, to me, is autonomy. It's about cultural aspects. They focused and made fun teams actually, and create fluid structures which can move around based on the need of the hour actually. The problem with this framework or that framework comes is like, they may be learning on their own as well, but that's not the point actually. It looks like we want to make sure that they create a dish for us all the time. So whatever dish comes to us, we'll eat it. So it's not that we also need to make an effort. Like what are we looking at actually? What is making sense to us? And in that context, it may happen that no ideas in the existing world is really working for us. Maybe we need to invent something else actually. As and when that thinking is there, people move away from shoe level stuff actually.
I just want to call out one thing. You mentioned about autonomy, you're spot on. But what enables that autonomy is that failure is celebrated. Failure is not a look down upon negatively. Yeah. See, I think one of the reasons in my experience why people rely on frameworks, right? It is because if something goes wrong, you can easily blame the framework, saying, I have done exactly as per the framework. And if something has not worked, that is not my problem. It's like, okay, you go to IBM and you buy software, or you go to TCS and you outsource your delivery. You're like, I've had the best brand, you know, and if something goes wrong, it's not my problem.
Absolutely.
Right? So I think people cling on to frameworks because they can pass on the blame on that framework, saying if something has not worked, it's not my problem. I've implemented the framework. I've done my job. So I think this is where that culture build, that autonomy, that you think to try something new, that encouragement to do that. I think that has to be encouraged. That somewhere, this cultural change has to happen, which I think people have fought. And I think in the instances where I have seen safe implementations, it's just that they have taken it and implemented it, saying, I've implemented safe. Now, whatever the results are, is not my problem.
Yeah.
So first type of agile coach should self-realize that, are they really agile coach? That's all I would like to say.
But as,
so growth that, mindset, I think, this, right?
This is
all mindset change.
Yeah. So this is what you just mentioned, Sunil. I think that is one of the reason why the number of percentage, which is 94%, organizations are not able to really release the fruit of the agility. And
that's
one of the reasons.
Yeah, exactly.
6% may be doing that, and all those 6% are really using their head. They are not just relying on one framework or another. They are looking at what really works for them.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you, ShriKant.
So the next point is when decisions are taken from trade-offs point of view. Could you give some examples? So let me give an example like. More autonomy, a high amount of autonomy or an alignment. So this may be an example like, do you want to have, huge amount of autonomy and there is no alignment? Is that the idea? Or you want to have the high alignment or low autonomy? So you need to see like what are the trade-offs, and sometimes you see that based on what works for you, actually, you decide based on that. You experiment with some ideas, and then you see that it is not really working. And there may be some values and principles which may be guiding you in this whole process. With that, you find out, oh, this is not really working for us. Maybe we need to have some balance around it. And that's where you just take the pause over there and use it. So that's the point. Like, there may not be nothing right and wrong. You experiment, you do the empiricism. You get the result out of that, and then you see that it's working and you go from there. Does it help your questions actually? Not sure who asked this question. Chapter in Spotify is equal to component teams in Safe, really? No. Component teams are not really chapters. Chapter is like, so I want to have a community of backend developers speak to each other around their self-development, have conversation about that. And that is a community within a tribe, which may be called as a chapter.
So can we say a chapter is more like community of practice?
Yes, you can call it as a community practice as well. So there may be a community for example, testing or front-end developer, back-end developer. So it is all about making sure that there is a self-learning in that community within a tribe. Does it make sense? And you, as if you see that, this is completely different than what component team is all about. Any size limitation for Squad, Train, and Guild? So Squad is, as I said, like it's a kind of scrum team. And so it will be having all those guidelines for the size of it. Train has a limitation of 125 people, I think, 125 people. And Guild is a kind of community of practice, actually, which may be going beyond your tribe. So multiple tribes may be having that guild. So for example, I want to have a agile guild. So in whoever is having an interest around that particular skill, then they may join these guilds. Similarly, we just created one guild in our group, in our Agile Commune groups as well as WhatsApp group. So there is a testing guild now, we have the PO guild as well. So anybody can join, so it doesn't have any kind of limit, size limitation as far as the guild is concerned. We can take more questions, but I think time is going away. So I hope you enjoyed this conversation. I'm not sure how, because this was the first time I was delivering this presentation ever, actually. So there may be some issues, but I hope you get some ideas based on this discussion.
Well done, Shrikant. Thank you so much. Very insightful.
Yes, Shrikant, definitely.
Thanks, Shrikant.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Shrikant. Yeah. You got really a very helpful. Nice background as well.
Very pleasant background.
Very yes. Pleasant.
Thank you, Shrikant. Refreshed a few things, but also hearing few different points of view is always good, right? We are always learning. So thank you for sharing your knowledge.
I guess you built it up nicely, like a nice story writer. So that's what I loved about it. Thanks.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that... What kind of situation, like you go for Spotify, you go for Safe, it is all based on the context you are living in.
Right, thanks, Shrikant. For the practical sessions and your thought process to get people on the ground, I really appreciate that. And this was a good refresher. One thing I'm taking away with Spotify is it is away from the agile cult. So any agile adoptions or transformation should be driven by their own context. So, I'm taking this away from this webinar. Thank you.
Actually, any kind of successful organization who are doing the agility, you will find that they are experimenting their own. Even ING did the similar things.
Absolutely.
They are still evolving right now. So they don't just follow one defined path. They keep on doing whatever makes sense for them.
Correct. However, I've also read or seen YouTube videos about ING, and I know few companies who have directly copy pasted the terminology of Spotify. So
never works here actually.
Copy paste. Yeah, but the concept is good, so it could be picked up.
No. Actually, it's not. That is a problem. Actually, that's what I'm saying. That it is not the structured or the squared or chapters. The inherent point was their culture, which was about encouraging the failures, the focus on the autonomy, and most of the times people just miss that. I mean, everything else they can take for their recommendations.
Yeah, I think we just want to make one point. People follow Scrum. How many people know there are five values behind behind Scrum?
Absolutely.
Can anybody name those five values? Very few can.
Yeah. And those values and principles exactly were the driving force for Spotify. Transparency, the autonomy also comes as part of the Scrum value. I mean, principle actually, so Scrum values. When they focus on giving development team autonomy and define the sprint backlog. So a lot of different ideas which are part of the Spotify came from these principles only. They are the driving force.
Also, Shikhan, like, I think like for the Spotify, right, you, as an organization, we should be very strong with the technology also. If you don't have, a good technology infrastructure within your organization, then it will be a little difficult to follow the Spotify, some of the Spotify rules, right?
But what do you think? The important point is that don't follow anything. See
correct.
What makes sense for you. You may start evolving from there. Try to understand your problems. See what may work for in that situation instead of copy-pasting something. You may get inspiration from some ideas. That's all about it. But your problem domain is your own problem domain, which everybody needs to understand.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. See you, ShriKant. Bye bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks, ShriKant.
Thanks, ShriKant. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks, ShriKant. It was a nice informative session.
Yes, guys. Bye.
Thanks.
Bye.
Thanks, ShriKant.
Thank you.